In this video, I'm going to demonstrate how to perform a venipuncture or phlebotomy procedure. The first thing we want to do is greet the patient and tell them why we are there. Then we want to positively identify the patient by asking for their full name and a unique identifier such as their address, date of birth, or medical record number. We want to avoid asking the patient, "Are you Armando Mannequin or John Doe?" because they might reflexively say yes. If the patient has capacity, they should supply an answer, and we can be assured that that answer is correct. However, if the patient does not have capacity, we can compare the information on their armband with the information we have on the requisition slip. So for this patient, his name is Armando Mannequin. He has a date of birth of May 9th, 1987, and a medical record number of 216-1988. And we can compare that information from the requisition slip and the armband and see that everything matches. Now that we've properly identified the patient, we can grab the correct tubes needed for the test order. This patient needs a red top tube and a purple top tube. I like to set them on my non-dominant side so that I can easily reach them during the venipuncture in the order that I'll need them so that the tube that I draw first is closest to the patient. All your materials should be put on the side of your non-dominant hand so that you do not have to cross over your body during the draw in order to grab supplies. Now we can assess the patient for their veins by tying a tourniquet around their bicep about 3 to 4 inches above the draw site in the antecubital fossa by pulling the tourniquet tight away from their skin so you don't pinch their skin, cross the left tail under the right tail, pinch the intersection between your fingers, and then tuck the tail into the band, leaving a small fold and a tail that you can pull to quickly release the tourniquet. Once the tourniquet is tied, you can have the patient make a fist, and you want the patient to just hold the fist rather than pumping it. Then you can palpate for the vein using your index finger or middle finger to track the depth and direction of the vein. It should feel spongy and bouncy. You don't want to palpate with your thumb because your thumb has a pulse, and it would be difficult to tell apart your pulse from the patient's pulse. And we don't want to stick a needle into anything that has a pulse because that would mean it was an artery, and we want to stick a needle into the vein. So once we've tracked the depth and direction of the vein, we can release the tourniquet so we don't hemoconcentrate the patient's blood, and then assemble our supplies based on our assessment of the patient's vein. This patient had very large veins, so we can use a straight tube holder. In order to assemble this, you have a needle assembly and a tube holder, and you can remove the needle by twisting the cap to break the paper seal and pulling it off and discarding that piece. And then you can see that there is a silicone sheath covering a needle, and that needle will puncture the vacutainer tubes. You can twist the needle into the tube holder until it is finger tight. This apparatus is designed to be held between your thumb and fingers, kind of like you hold a remote control. It should be held loosely, and you can see that there's a safety device that when you pull it back will allow the bevel of the needle to be facing up. You want your thumb underneath that safety device so that you can activate it once the needle is out of the patient's arm. And then you can set it off to the side so that it's ready for you to use. Now you can grab the sterile alcohol pads that you'll use to clean the patient's arm, and we can open that up so it's ready and set it off to our non-dominant side, as well as two pieces of gauze. One to cover the puncture site when we remove the needle, and another clean one to bandage the patient's arm. Now that we've gathered our supplies, we can tie a quick release tourniquet midway up the bicep by crossing the left tail under the right tail, and then tucking the now right tail into the band. Then we can palpate for the vein, find any visual markers to help us find the vein again, and then clean it with alcohol by going back and forth across the puncture site. We will then allow that alcohol to dry on the patient's skin before performing the venipuncture. While the alcohol is drying, we can grab the tube holder and needle and hold it in our dominant hand between with our thumb on top and our fingers on the bottom so that we can maintain good control of the needle and good contact with the patient's skin. We can pull back the safety feature. And these are designed so that the safety feature is in line with the bevel. And then we can dock our first tube. In order to dock it, you don't want to push the tube all the way onto the needle because that would clear the vacuum. And you also want to spin the label so that it's facing down so we can see the blood drain into the tube. Now that the alcohol is dry, we can remove the cap of the needle, inspect the bevel of the needle for damage, and then use our non-dominant hand to anchor the vein by pressing our thumb into the patient's skin below the draw site and pulling down on the skin. Then we can insert the needle with the bevel up at a 15 to 30 degree angle, remove our thumb that was anchoring the vein, and then rest the fingers of our dominant hand against the patient's forearm to hold the needle steady. To push the tube onto the needle, we place our thumb on the bottom of the tube and our index finger on the top ledge of the tube holder, and then we pinch our fingers together. Then we can see if the tube is filling with blood, and we can spin the label around so that we can see the blood drain into the tube. If we aren't in the vein, we can slowly advance and retreat the needle by moving our thumb backwards and forwards. At this point, you can release the tourniquet. Once the tube has filled, you'll use your middle finger under the tube and your thumb on the top of the tube, and then use your index finger against the ledge of the tube holder to push against the tube holder and pop the tube off the tube holder. And then you can gently invert the tube. Keep in mind that your finger should be resting in the patient's forearm to keep the needle steady. Then you can grab your next tube and put your thumb under the bottom, your index fingers on the tube holder ledge, and then push it on by pinching your fingers together. And you can spin the label around so you can see the blood fill into the tube. The entire time, your hand is holding steady against the patient's arm. Once the tube has filled, you can pop the tube off by placing your middle finger under the tube, your thumb on top, and using your index finger against the ledge of the tube holder. Gently invert the tube to mix the blood with the anticoagulants, and then set it to the side. Next, you'll grab a clean piece of gauze after ensuring that the tourniquet is not on the patient's arm anymore, and place the gauze gently over the insertion site. Quickly pull the needle out, apply pressure with your non-dominant hand, and then activate the safety shield using your thumb, and then dispose of the needle into the sharps container. At this point, you can continue to apply pressure until the patient has stopped bleeding, or if the patient has capacity, they can apply pressure while you start to label the tubes. It's good practice to assess the patient at this point and ask them how they're feeling, because a patient might have a vasovagal reaction, which can present as nausea, vomiting, dizziness, or loss of consciousness. Check that the patient has stopped bleeding, then discard the dirty gauze into the biohazard, and take the clean piece of gauze and fold it into quarters and apply it to the puncture site so that when you bandage the patient's arm, that gauze applies additional pressure. You can use a Band-Aid to hold the gauze in place, or a Coban like shown in the video. You should counsel the patient that they should keep the bandage on for at least 15 minutes and avoid heavy lifting for an hour or two in order to avoid reopening the puncture site. Now that we've bandaged the patient, we can label our tubes in the presence of the patient. We need to include the patient's full name, a unique identifier such as the medical record number, date of birth, or their address, as well as the date and time of the collection and the initials of the collector. Our patient's name is Armando Mannequin, and it's important to ensure that the name is spelled correctly. Then you would include a unique identifier, such as their medical record number, as well as the date and time of the collection. Most hospitals will utilize a barcode system where this information is included in the barcode. And finally, the initials of the collector. Once the tubes are labeled, you will package them into a biohazard bag with the requisition slip and send them to the lab. The lab will then independently verify that the information on the label matches the requisition slip. Once you have sent the samples off, you can take off your gloves and wash your hands.